morning.
Good morning.
What a privilege. Are you well this morning? Will you open your heart this morning? Will you keep it open? I have something to share with you. I believe that it's going to be powerful. It's part three of a series that I have been preaching, and my flesh wants to compete with Mark by how long it's been since I preached, because, you know, we get to do this every once in a while, but to be honest, I don't remember. So, we started the first part of the series, if you didn't hear it, was about story. Why story? And we talked about how it's the language of our heart. You know, information is the language of our mind. Facts are up here. Story moves into our heart. It was the language that Jesus used. He modeled it for us. It was the language he learned from his father. It's the way that we make sense of our life, and it's the reason why movies and books have so much power, why they move us, because they borrow their power from his story that we're a part of. And each of us has a role, has a place, has a part in that grand epic. Right, John Eldridge helped us to see that a little bit, and Dwight Mason, two books that we read a little bit out of. The second part was about co-authoring, and how we have a role not just in the story as a character, but actually we have power in this story to co-author with God. We touched on some of the elements, the setting, and whatnot, but really we spent most of our time wrestling with our responsibility as co-authors with God. And the summary is that some parts of our life story, he decided, right? We had no control and he decided some parts, but some parts were decided by us, by the choices and the decisions that we made. And that's the same thing moving forward. And so we have to own it, and we have to co-author on purpose with God. Okay? Ultimately, the level of our harmony, as the pastor just prayed, the level of harmony or unity or peace in our life is fully determined on our ability to trust him. Our ability to trust him and his plan, his purposes, his direction, his guidance. Alright? So that brings us to part three, which we're going to focus on characters. I want to call this character shifts. You know, when you shift something, you move it, you change it. And so we want to focus in, we touched on it briefly before, but it's worth mentioning the two types. There are mainly two types of characters in your story. There are spiritual characters, you know, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, Yahweh, the Savior, the Holy Spirit, the devil, his demons, angels. These things are at work around us. We got into that a little bit about who the hero and the villain are. But there are also physical characters, our earthly characters, right? Our self, our parents, our family, our spouse, our kids, teachers, mentors, friends, bosses, co-workers, clients, coaches, doctors, pastors, neighbors, role models, strangers, enemies, etc., etc. You know, it goes on down the list. And so today we're going to focus on these physical or earthly characters for the most part. For some today, I believe this will be just a reflective time that's just going to make you smile. It's just going to be a time of joy. For some, this will be freeing for you. For some, it will be healing. And for some, it will be boring. Right? I mean, I'm just being honest. Thank you. Well, I hope not, but it's reality. Anyway, over my adult years, I grew up without an earthly father, and so I've become acutely aware of the people that are in my life, that have been in my life over my journey. Psalm 68:5 says, "A father to the fatherless, a defender of widows, is God in his holy dwelling." And as I got to a certain stage in my life, and I began to look back on my life, God began to help me see how he placed people in my life to father me and fill the gap where my earthly father was not there. primarily for me, was a varsity basketball coach. It was my grandpa. And it was my friend's fathers who I got to know in my early years. And then I got to college, and I was fortunate to come into a father-in-law and then a number of mentors along the way. I didn't know that at the time. I didn't understand. I didn't see that. But it's amazing when you look back how you can see how God puts people and moves and does things in their life. And so this experience also helped me become aware of the way that I can be and demonstrate and manifest His presence in other people's lives. The way, not just serve people, again, that's bad, and not just help people, but be His presence. You hear what I'm saying there? These people were His presence in my life. His grace, His mercy, His correction, His guidance, His comfort. They didn't just help me. They loved me. And therefore, I can now go and be that in other people's lives. Which is probably a large reason why I am an elementary school teacher in a city setting where lots of kids don't have fathers. I believe that God called me to that. He put a heart and a passion, put a passion in my heart for that. But the point is that it's not just that people have come into my life. It's that now I, or we, or you can now go into other people's life, right? All right. So, these lives, we are either invited into or we are allowed into. And I want to talk about the difference there for just a second. So just as you and I have and continue to invite characters into our life, right? We ask people to come into our life. We want them to come in. It's our desire. We may be invited into other people's stories. You know, they ask us. Whether as a mentor, whether as a pastor, whether as a coach, whether as a teacher, whether as a, you know, whatever, a friend. Okay? And so, when we are invited into someone else's story, this is where we get out of our own story and really get into His story. Okay? This is where we get out of our own story and begin to work in His story. So you know the friends, the mentors, the authors, the teachers, the neighbors, the strangers, etc. For example, you know, it starts with a breakfast and it turns into a brotherhood, right? You ask her to get dinner and now you're married. Invited. And it turns into something much more. Another way, more frequently, I believe, is the way that we allow characters into our story. And I say allow because it's like they just happen, right? It's like they were just put there. You didn't really intentionally invite them in. They didn't really intentionally ask you to come in. All of a sudden, one day, you're just in each other's story. And you're just friends or family or enemies. I don't know. But they just kind of happen. And so we allow that to happen. This past week, I sat with some students that are heading off to college. And, you know, as I think about it, I was just blown away by these two specifically, and a number of others, but specifically these two, that they would allow me and my wife to be a part of their story. The two high school kids would have enough time, would have enough interest to want to hear what we have to say, to want to be around us. And so they allowed that. They didn't invite us necessarily. It just kind of happened. You know, we're in the same place, we kind of have similar interests, and a similar thing happened. Interesting thing happened. We were at a wedding last night at a reception, and we found out we were at the former co-workers' table, you know, at this reception. And as we started talking to each other, like, oh, I'm looking for over here, oh, yeah, I'm looking for over here. And so I'm looking at this reception, and here's where you really get a picture of it. There's this main table, and then there's this family table, right? And this table of honor with the brides and these characters that are like the main people in their life. And then you have this whole room full of other characters in their life, and then you have a whole earth of people who weren't invited, or who don't know them, right? And so you can't forget about that, but each of these people has some sort of significant role in their life. enough that they would invite them to come and share this moment. It was just interesting that my wife and this woman, they met at work and have carried on a relationship since then. So they both kind of allowed it to happen. So those are the two types that we can control, and that's the co-authoring, and then there's the third type. There's the ones, the people that you're stuck with. I had a feeling that you guys would resonate with that, right? You guys know what I'm talking about, the ones you were born, the family you were born into, maybe, the marriage that you've entered into, the work or church position, you know, you've got this new job, and you get there, and oh man, et cetera, et cetera. And that goes back to the ones that brings into your life, or maybe someone else brings into your life. But we'll get to that. Regardless, remember this. Regardless of that you're doing or not, remember, no character, no author ever creates a character for no reason. No character is ever created for no purpose. Now, it may not necessarily be for your story. They may just be in the background. They may just be off in the distance in your story. But listen, every character that you encounter, every person that you're around has been created for a purpose. And now, listen, they may not be fulfilling their purpose. They may not yet be redeemed into the story. And so, even if they're doing evil, doesn't mean that there can't be redemption, right?
I'm going to go downstairs and see how this works.
So that's the how they got your story, right? That's how people get into your story, how you get into theirs. And now for the where. Where do they fit in your story? Generally speaking, each story has major characters and minor characters. Would you agree? Right? And looking back on my life, it's interesting to see people that I thought were major characters, that I thought were major characters in my life, were really just minor characters. I'm living long enough now to have that kind of experience and ability to see that. For example, my high school buddies, friends forever, right? You know, that girlfriend that I thought we were going to be together forever, and I thought these were major players in my story. I thought, man, when we're 40 and 50, and again, not that that can't happen, some of you, that's a different story, but for me, I thought these were the major players in my story. In college, it happened again. I left and went off to college, and you know, away from home, and I formed some new friendships. And we lived together with these guys, and they were in my wedding. Oh man, these are my buddies for life. And you know, we're going to vacation together, we're going to meet up, and we're going to raise our families together. And I thought they were major players. And then God moved me again here to Poland, and I was in Canada, and here I am in Poland. And for the first time in my life, after that, I began to feel guilty about how am I going to keep up with all these people? How am I going to be a good friend to my high school friends, my college friends, and here I am in a new place, and you know, I want to bloom, I want to plant it, I want to build relationships here, and God helped me see for the first time the whole concept of seasons, right? And what we'll call as chapters, to go with our analogy, and to realize, like, listen, they're not sitting around waiting, where's Nick? And I can't believe he hasn't called me. They're living their life, and they're moving on. And what happens is, you know, we can carry this guilt for being a bad friend when all we really need to realize is there's something bigger at work here, right? And each stage of our life brings us seasons. And it's okay to move on from that. We'll get back to that in a second, too. And so, there's also things in my life that, looking back, that I thought were minor things, but were really major players in my life. My church family growing up, you know, to be honest, I kind of considered them minor characters. But looking back, they were major characters. Major. Because, first of all, they're still a part of my life. They still get screen time in my story. Second of all, I thought that my coaches, and specifically one coach, I thought he was a minor character. The time. And he was just my coach. I didn't really, to be honest, at the time, I didn't really care. But as I look back, I realize what a major player, what a major character was in my life. And to get off the physical for a second, spiritually speaking, Jesus. Jesus, I saw him as a minor character, to be honest. But now, I realize what a major character he is in this story. So, the longer you live, you begin to realize this, this whole concept of seasons and chapters. You know, and you begin to be able to navigate a little better through these times and these moves in your life. So, what determines if someone's a major character or minor character? Real simply, screen time, right? You watch a movie, you read a book, their screen time, their presence, the amount of time. And the thing I guess I've struggled with a little bit is, what about if they have a major role? If they did something in your life, maybe in one chapter they were a life-changing piece. And I don't want you to hear me saying that that doesn't mean they weren't important, they didn't do something really major. It just means they were just there for a short time. Because here's what happens. If someone's life has changed because of something I did in their life, my presence in their life, say Nick's presence in your life changed your life. Is it because Nick is so great? Or is it because, hopefully, Nick manifested God's love through his life into you? That I participated in the ministry of reconciliation. Now, my flesh would like to say it's so great, but my wife would say it's not. And so, but the point is that, you know, I don't want you to not, it's not that I don't want you to look back in your life and say, oh, I've had some amazing people in my life. That's not what I'm saying. Maybe you've been fortunate to have amazing people, but here's the deal. What I want you to do is I want you to look at the characters of your story and be overwhelmed by the way your Heavenly Father has pursued you and has made provision for you and has used people, even people you didn't think he would use, to reach out and draw you in. Even the most unlikely people in your life. Even the most unlikely situation that came because of those people. Even if it was people, maybe, that didn't leave you better off. Maybe it was someone who loved you in pain. But that pain turned you, maybe for the first time, towards a God that so loves you. And so, let's get into our tendencies a little bit with this. We have this tendency, as humans, to make minor characters majors. And what should be major characters, or main characters in our story, we make them minor. Do you agree? Have you seen that at work in your life? Have you ever done that? Have you ever tried to make someone more than they should be in your life? Or in someone else's life? Have you ever tried to make yourself more than you should be in someone else's life? And vice versa, have you ever tried to make your spouse less than they should be? Have you ever allowed yourself to be less, or made yourself less than you should be in someone else's life? And so, how do you know? How do you figure all this out? This is the beauty of His Spirit and His Word, and why we do this week after week after week, why we continue to seek Him, right? So sometimes, when those things happen, we need a shift. And that's why I want to talk to you about a shift, a character shift. Sometimes we need to make a little shift, maybe with ourselves or with a character in our story. See, it can happen so easily. You know, we want something more from our spouse than they can give us. We want something more from our pastor than they can give us. We want our friends to be more than they are able to be. You want to be best friends. I just want, all I can give you is occasional friends. You want me to be a mentor? I just don't have the time and the ability to be a mentor. And you can see that on and on and on. See, what this does is it reveals our idolatry. Ooh, I brought up a big word. Idolatry, right? See, our characters, they're out of position. Minors are majors, and majors are minors. You know, you see this culturally with our athletes. Can we talk about that? Athletes are characters. But they're just, in my opinion, a little out of position. You see it in our modern parenting. You hear this critique that kids, they're out of position. My two-year-old, her life is all about her. And if my life is all about her and continues to be as a parent, why would I ever expect that her life, that she would grow up and her life wouldn't be about her? Right? And so, and I know this is tricky, and I'm not like going to give you the answer or some, but what I'm saying is, as a parent, you become aware of this reality that, like, this, I love them and I just want to, you know, make them they're everything to me, versus like, well, wait, maybe they need to see that actually Jesus is everything to me. That Jesus' call and direction on my life is more important to me than them. Right? In love. And you can see the rest of it. You can see the reality. The struggle is, well, what if God's calling me to do something, but it's not good for my kids? Well, then we would never have a missionary, right, that had kids. Right? We would never have anybody that goes into another part of the world that isn't suburban, safe America that has kids. Is that, maybe that's a little exaggerated, but I'm doing that on purpose to make the point. The challenge that we have to, who are the main and the major and the minor characters in our story? Or maybe you're just really loyal and you are a really committed friend and person, but you just lost sight of the larger story of words. You know, when we hold on longer than we should, I want you to turn with me to John chapter 13, if you would. And it was really neat to see this in Scripture. And you see it all throughout. You know, you see Jesus inviting characters in his story, his disciples, and many other people. You see people allowing Jesus into their story. In John 13, verse 36, we're going to read a little bit about Peter and Jesus and their interaction. And this, I feel like, is just profound. Peter said to him, "Lord, where are you going?" And Jesus answered him, "Where I am going, you cannot follow me now, but you shall follow me afterwards." Peter said to him, "Lord, why can I not follow you now? I will lay down my life for your sake." And Jesus answered him, "Will you lay down your life for my sake? Most assuredly, I say to you, the rooster shall not crow till you have denied me 3 times. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself. That where I am, there you may also be." And so we can look at this theologically and talk about Jesus going and ascending and what he's doing. But let's look at this from a human's perspective, from a human emotional situation. Let's think about this. Peter and Jesus have walked together for 3 years. For 3 years, they have been brothers. Peter walked away from his life to follow him. He's watched him do amazing things. Peter thought they would be friends, but they would be together forever. I thought this was how we were going to do this life together. He loved us. I mean, let's not get caught up in the fact that Peter would deny him right now. Peter, in his heart, believed that he and Jesus would be friends forever. This is his friend. This is his brother. And Jesus says, I have to go. Wait a minute. Wait a minute. Jesus, this is not. I'm not ready to let go of you yet. I'll die for you. Where do we have to go? I will go. I will die. This is how much I love you. This is how much I want this relationship to work out. This friendship. And Jesus says, you know, we read that so quickly and we gloss over, we look at the denying, we look at the theological, and we miss the part. I imagine what Jesus must have been looking at Peter and saying, I love you. Something bigger at work here than you and me. Something much bigger than what we have here. As great as it's been, as special as it's been, I know you thought it would be for 10, 20, 30, 40 years. There's something more at work. And don't get me wrong, the opposite also happens. People also give up too quickly. And by the way, I'm not talking about marriage here. I just felt like I needed to make that clear. That's a covenant relationship. That's a whole other situation than holding on too long or giving up too easy, which requires a whole other set of, you know, teaching and situations. But what I want you to see here is to thrive in his story, we have to be able to see and navigate character transitions in our life, character shifts, both in our story and in his story. Whether it's the friendships, whether it's church families, whether it's our children, whether it's our mentors, we need to be able to make character transitions. We need to be able to let people go off into the things that they need to do, that God has called them, that God has ordained and decided for them, that may not be best for us, and may not be what we want. Okay? For example, Jesus at the age of 13, what was he doing, right? His mom can't find him. And he's off with the rabbis because he was beginning to move into his next season of life, his next calling. But as a mother, you can imagine what Mary's thinking, right? At 13, do you think she realized she was beginning to let him go? She had to begin letting him go. And she had to make a shift and as her character in Jesus' story. Jesus knew, I'm doing what I'm supposed to do here. But of course, you know, Mary and the emotion and the, you know, the reality of that situation, I can imagine. You know? Our kids go off to college. You know, as parents, we have to come to grips with the shift in our place, in our role in their life, right? And kids, they pretty easily, most of them pretty easily come to the realization of that. Our child gets married, right? Father, especially, the mom and dad have to make a shift in their roles and their characters. You know, families moving on from the church for whatever reason. Maybe healthy, good reasons, maybe we suspect not. But we got to be able to let them go. Friend moves across the country, or he meets a nice girl. All of a sudden, doesn't have as much time. All of a sudden, situation shift. We have to be able to make those shifts in our life. A mentoring season is over. Maybe we didn't want it to be over. Maybe we don't like the way it ended. But we need to be able to make these character shifts in our life. It doesn't mean these things don't hurt. And it doesn't mean that they're easy. Especially if they don't happen the right way. When I say the right way, and I mean in the healthy way. I'm talking, you know, someone just quits calling, someone just kind of disappears. And that makes it all the more complicated, all the more messy. But it doesn't mean that it's not time to move on. And it doesn't mean that it's not time to let go. It doesn't mean that you can find hope in the greater thing at work here right now. It just means this, that it's not all about. It's just not all about. There's something greater than our own individual story. And so I close with this. Questions. Reflections. Are there majors that need demoted? Or minors that need promoted? Are there main characters in your story that need to become supporting roles? Are there characters that you need to invite into your story? Or a lightly dismissed, an unhealthy relationship, you don't have the time, a season is over, you're not the person that God has in mind for this man or woman or child or teenager. Someone else, there are other people, right, to do these things. What a freeing thought. If you're anything like me with a time to say your complex, well, who's there? I mean, you look around this room and you look around, there's many churches like this with people with willing hearts. Are there characters you need to allow into your story? Maybe you can keep them out. Or are there characters you need to unallow? You need to keep up. You need to refuse access. You need to resist. They are bad company which corrupts good character. They're suckers. There's a discernment that Pastor Mark talked about a couple weeks ago. There's a discernment saying, no, it's just not right here. That's okay. And specifically, this is where it all comes down to. We've talked mostly about physically, but spiritually. Specifically this. Where is Jesus in your story? And where are you in this story? Is he a main character? A major character? Is he a minor character? So we're going to take just a minute here. Spirit, say what he needs to say to your heart, or continue to say what he's already been saying. How do I make these decisions, Pastor? How do I know, or how do I do this if I need to let someone go? Listen, that's the beauty of this right here. That's the beauty of his word. That's the beauty of his spirit. There's not one answer. I can tell you three or four things. Go through this, pray, and read your Bible, and listen for God's voice, and I believe you would do all those things, but maybe you need to talk to someone. Maybe you already know, and you just need someone to pray and help you have the courage to do it. Or maybe you just need to take a step. So that's what we're going to just give the Holy Spirit a minute there. thank you. I thank you for the way that you pursue us. I praise you, Lord, that as you knit us together, you would not quit, you would not give up, that you decided that we would be redeemed for your righteousness, that we would have a place as co-laborers, as co-authors, and not just that our story, Father, would end at the cross, would begin and end at the foot of the cross, but that we could join you. And be a part of other stories that begin and end at the cross. Give us.
This great epic. Oh, how we love you.